Hanover Square Press and Harper Audio present What You Are Looking For Is in the Library, a novel by Michiko Aoyama, translated by Alison Watts, performed by Hanako Footman, Kenichiro Thomson, Susan Momoko Hingley, Winson Ting, and Shiro Kawai.
Chapter 1. Tomoka, 21, women's wear sales assistant. When Saya sends a text to tell me she has a new boyfriend, I instantly write back, "What's he like?" But all she replies is, "He's a doctor." Nothing about looks or personality or what kind of doctor he is. I mean, he could be any kind, couldn't he? It's true I know what she means by doctor. Jobs can be a clue to somebody's character, a shortcut way of describing them, but only in a limited, stereotyped sort of way. That starts me thinking, what do people think about me based on my job? What does it say about my personality or qualities? I've known Saya since high school. She's a friend from back home who's kept in touch ever since I left to come to college in Tokyo. She sends me texts every now and then, bit by bit. The story of how she met her new boyfriend at a party appears on the pale sky blue screen of my smartphone. Then she writes, "How are you doing?" With my finger poised above the screen, I tap B and Brilliant pops up in the auto predict. So I just select it and tap send. What I really meant to say, though, was bored. I work at Eden. That sounds like paradise, doesn't it? But it's actually a chain of general merchandise stores, not as upmarket as a department store. Every morning I put on my tight black skirt and matching waistcoat to go and spend the day serving customers and working behind the till. I started this job 6 months ago after graduating from junior college. The time has flown by. I started in spring and now it's nearly winter. In November, when the heating was turned on in the store, my feet started getting sweaty inside my stockings, making my toes squish together and bunch up in my tight pumps. Most women who have to wear a uniform at work probably feel the same. The thing that makes the Eden uniform special, though, are the blouses. They're a kind of peachy orange colour called coral pink, which was selected by a famous colour coordinator. We learned that during training. Coral pink supposedly projects a bright, caring image and is flattering to women of all ages. I saw the coordinator's point when I started work in my assigned section of women's wear. "Miss Fujiki, I've had my break. You can go next." That's Mrs. Numauchi, one of the part-time workers. When she returns to the counter, her lips look shiny and moist, obviously retouched. Mrs. Numauchi is an old hand who's been working here the last 12 years. Last month, when it was her birthday, she said that she'd reached a number with two digits the same. She can't be 44 or 66, so I guess she's 55, around my mother's age. Like I said, I really get it about the coral pink. It looks good on Mrs. Numauchi, too. That colour coordinator must have been aware that most of the staff here are part-time older women. "Miss Fujiki, you've been cutting it close coming back from your break recently. You should be more punctual." "I'm sorry." Mrs. Numauchi is really bossy. She's so picky about trivial things and sometimes acts like she's in charge. But she's usually right, so I put up with it. "Okay, I'm going," I say, and bow to take my leave. While walking across the shop floor, I stop to straighten some clothes that I happen to notice are out of place. "Excuse me," a customer calls. I turn round to see a lady in a frumpy old down jacket with a frayed backpack. Even though she must be as old as Mrs. Numauchi, she doesn't have any makeup on. "Which one do you like best?" she asks, and holds up two knitted tops in turn, a mulberry V-neck followed by a light brown turtleneck. In women's wear, we don't make a point of approaching customers as the staff at in-store boutiques do. I'm really glad of that, but if a customer asks for help, then of course I have to assist. Let me see, I say, looking at each one to compare them, secretly wishing I'd ignored the untidy shelf and gone straight out on my break. I point to the mulberry top. This one's nice, don't you think? Very elegant. Do you think so? It's not too flamboyant for me. No, not at all. But if you're looking for something less conspicuous, the brown one would be nice and warm around the neck. But I think it might be a bit drab. And so on and so on. The pointless exchange drags on. I ask if she'd like to try the tops on, but no, that's too much trouble. I have to stop myself from sighing. Touching the mulberry top, I say to her, "This is a lovely colour, and it really suits you, I think." "You do?" The customer stares at it for a long time, then looks up. At last, is she going to make up her mind? "Well, I suppose I'll take it," she says, and goes off to pay for it at the till. Hooray! I fold the brown turtleneck and return it to the shelf. There go 15 minutes of my precious break down the drain. As I'm heading through the staff exit at the rear, one of the girls from a brand boutique on the same floor brushes past me. She's wearing a gorgeous moss green and white country-style check skirt that flares out and swings as she walks. She has her hair up in a cute bun to complete the look. I wonder if her clothes are from the boutique. Uniforms aren't compulsory for boutique staff. They can wear their own clothes. Having girls like that around makes even Eden feel a bit more of a cool place. I collect the vinyl tote bag with my lunch things in it from the locker room, then head for the staff canteen. It has a pretty limited lunch menu, soba or udon noodles, curry or a weekly special set lunch that always has something deep fried. I ordered lunch from the canteen a few times, but then I got my head bitten off once by the woman in the kitchen when I told her she'd made a mistake with my order. So now I buy a sandwich or savoury roll at a convenience store on the way to work. Women's blouses dot the room in splashes of pink, among the men in their white shirts and boutique staff in casual dress. Four women part-timers at a table near me are having fun chatting and laughing noisily about their husbands and children. To a customer, I would look like one of them in my coral pink blouse. But to be honest, those ladies scare me. I can't stand up to them and try not to get into any kind of exchange with them. There is one reason and one reason only that I work at Eden. It was the only job offer I received. I didn't put much thought into my application. It was just one out of many that I sent off at the end of junior college. I didn't think there was much I was capable of doing anyway, so anywhere that was willing to take me was fine with me. I'd received about 30 rejections and was totally fed up by the time the offer from Eden arrived, so I accepted it immediately. Besides, it ticked the most important box for me. It was in Tokyo. But it wasn't that I wanted to live there so much as I didn't want to go back to the country. Where I come from is a long, long way from Tokyo. A place with rice fields, and more rice fields in every direction as far as the eye can see. The nearest convenience store is a 15-minute drive, and even that is just one lonely shop all by itself on a main road. Magazines always go on sale a few days later than they do anywhere else. There are no cinemas or fashion stores. Nothing you could call a restaurant either. The closest thing to eating out are the small local diners with set menus. I'd been dying of boredom there ever since I was a teenager and couldn't wait to get away at the first opportunity. I had an image of Tokyo from the dramas I used to watch on the four limited TV stations that were available to us. Tokyo was the ultimate, the dream city that had everything. If I could only make it there, my life too would be as cool and fun as the lives of the actresses I saw on TV. At least, that's what I believed. It was also what drove me to study hard at high school, so I could get into junior college in Tokyo. Once I'd made it here, however, I realized what a fantasy world I'd been living in. Tokyo is still a dream, though. I mean, there is always at least one convenience store within 5 minutes' walk, and the trains come every 3 minutes. Plus, Anything you could possibly want in the way of daily necessities and ready-prepared food is available at your fingertips at any time. After I'd been accepted for training with Eden, I was assigned to a store just one train stop away from where I was already living. Sometimes, though, I think about the future. What will I be doing years from now? I don't have the same kind of burning desire like I used to, when all I wanted was to escape to Tokyo. And I don't feel excited anymore about achieving a goal. That all fizzled away, like froth. Hardly anyone in my hometown goes to college in Tokyo, so having people tell me how amazing I was used to make me feel good. But when it comes down to it, I'm not amazing at all. I have no ambitions, nothing I enjoy. I don't even have a boyfriend. It's hard to see anyone since I don't have weekends off. I know there's more to it than that, but I still can't find a guy. The only reason I don't go back home is because I couldn't face the inconvenience of country life again. What will I do? I worry about the years slipping by while I stay on at Eden getting older and older. Living a life with no dreams or ambitions, getting old and wrinkled inside my coral pink blouse. Find a new job, Tomoka. This thought has been on my mind a lot recently, but it feels such a huge effort to do anything about it. Basically, I'm not very driven. Even writing a CV is a big hassle for me. Anyway, what else can a girl like me do? A young college leaver with no skills, who only Eden was willing to employ. "Hey, Tomoka," calls Kiriyama. He works behind the counter at the in-store branch of Zaz, a chain selling spectacles. He's 25, 4 years older than me, and the only person at Eden I can really talk to. His eyes are friendly. He started working here 4 months ago, but I haven't seen him in a while. Because he's an employee of Zaz, not Eden, he sometimes gets called to help at other Zaz branches. Kiriyama is holding a tray loaded with a deep-fried mackerel set lunch and a bowl of udon noodles topped with meat. For someone so thin, he really eats a lot. "Okay if I join you?" "Sure," I tell him, and he sits down opposite me. He wears thin-framed round glasses that really suit him. You can tell he's doing exactly what he should be doing, though I remember hearing that he did other work before Zaz. "Kiriyama, what did you used to do?" I ask. "Do? Me? Print production. Magazines, that kind of thing. Editing, writing, stuff like that." "Really? Wow." I didn't know he'd worked in publishing. All of a sudden, my impression of him switches from gentle-mannered nice guy to smart intellectual. See? Even previous jobs have the power to influence your image of a person. "Why so surprised?" "But you had an amazing job." Kiriyama smiles and slurps down his noodles. "Working in a glasses shop is also amazing." "Oh, sure, yeah." I smile too and take a bite of my sausage bread. "Amazing is your favourite word, isn't it, Tomoka?" Maybe. He might be right, though. When Saya was telling me about her boyfriend, I might have used the word amazing more than a few times. What do I think is amazing, I wonder? A special talent? A deep knowledge of something? A unique skill? "I'm gonna end up in Eden for the rest of my life," I whisper into my strawberry milk.
"What's up? Do you want to change jobs?"
"Yeah," I say, after a pause. "I've been thinking about it lately."
"Do you still want to work in customer service?"
"Yeah, but I wouldn't mind working in an office, so I can have weekends off and wear whatever I like, and have my own desk. I could go to a cafe near work for lunch with my colleagues and bitch about the boss in the tea room."
"I don't hear anything about the actual job in any of those scenarios," says Kiriyama. "That can't be helped. I mean, I don't even know myself what kind of job I want to do."
"But you're permanent, Tomoka. In a few years, you can transfer to head office, can't you?" "I guess so, but..." After starting with the company,
permanent staff have to put in 3 years at a branch store. Once you have the sales experience, you can apply for a transfer to head office. You can try for general affairs or human resources or product development and become a buyer or an event planner. Any of these would suit me. But I'd also heard that in reality, the chances of a transfer application being approved were low. The most realistic outcome was rising to division chief, like my uninspiring boss. Mr. Ueshima is 35 and has been in the same...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.